are some considerations when you're thinking about saving for your child's or grandchildren's future and perhaps their college education? Well, here to talk with me about that is Amy Shepherd from Sensible Money. Amy, welcome.
Hi, Bob. Thank you.
So you have firsthand knowledge of this question as a new mom, right?
Yes. So my husband and I, we have three kids, four, three, and newborn. And so we have had lots of conversations about what is the best way to save for their future. And also with clients, you know, I have clients asking often how to save for their children or grandchildren. So something that I've spent a lot of time thinking about.
So in terms of what, I guess, where do you begin when you start thinking about this question?
So I think the first step whenever you're talking about a financial decision is to forget about the money for a minute and think about what's the goal. And so with college savings or just saving for the future, that's the same first step is, you know, what is the goal that you have for that money? Are you wanting to save for college or are you just wanting to save for their future, which that could be a lot of different things. So that's where I always recommend starting is what do you want to accomplish with the money?
Right. And if you're anticipating that you're saving for college education, people have a variety of accounts that they could use.
Yes. So saving for college, there is a lot. The most common one that many people have heard of is a 529 plan. And, you know, personally, I think that is one of the best ones to use if the goal is college. With 529 plans, you can save a pretty substantial amount of money each year. Many states offer tax incentives for you to contribute to it. And now then there's long-term tax incentives too, that if you put the money in the 529 plan, it grows tax deferred. And then as long as you take the money out to pay for qualified education expenses, there is no tax on any of the earnings. So if you're certain that college is the goal, that is a really great account to use.
Right. And it's a great account for not only parents, but for grandparents and other relatives to fund as well.
It is, yes. Anybody can contribute to it. So one thing that is not very commonly known is that the ownership of the account does matter for financial aid. So I'm sure many people know financial aid. There's so many considerations, but one thing that's really important to know is that if a 529 is owned by a parent, it is more beneficial for financial aid purposes. And that's compared to if like a grandparent owns it, there is not as favorable treatment for financial aid. So best case scenario is a parent owns it, grandparents, aunt, uncles, anybody can contribute to it, but the parent is the owner and then the child is the beneficiary.
Right. And the child's the beneficiary, but if that child decides not to go to college, parents have some options in terms of what to do with the beneficiary.
They do. That's another great thing about the 529 plans is, you know, say you have multiple kids. So you open a 529 for your eldest and they decide not to go to college or they do go to college, but then there's money left over. You have the freedom to change the beneficiary. You can't change it to anyone, but it is a pretty, there's a lot of flexibility. So you can change it to what is referred to as a qualifying family member. But what a lot of people do is they change it to the next kid in line or, you know, the youngest child. So it does have that really great flexibility.
Right. And one other question about 529s before we move on is many states have their own 529. Massachusetts has one. Arizona has one. Any thoughts about whether you should use a 529 plan that's outside of your state?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So it depends on the tax incentives. I think that's one of the biggest things to look at. Sometimes in order to get the tax break, you have to contribute to your state's plan, but that's not always the case. There's always the consideration of like, where do you think your child is going to go to college? Certain state plans allow you to move, you know, allow you to use the assets to go to all of out of state colleges. Some don't. So I think just thinking about the flexibility and looking at, you know, the tax savings and just making sure that it's a thoughtful decision instead of just jumping into one without doing any research. I think that's the important thing.
Right. And then the investment option, I should just mention this too. Most of them are tied to the date that the child is expected to go to college, but there are other options as well.
There are other options. Yeah. Many people like those because they're easy. You know, they become more conservative as college becomes closer, which you don't have to really think about changing the investments, but you do have freedom to select from other investment options. Most state plans, they are fairly limited. They don't allow you to invest in anything under the sun, but they do have options.
Right. So other types of accounts that people might use for saving for a child's future?
Yeah, so one thing that people, you know, ask about a lot or hear about are UGMAs and UTMAs, funny sounding names. They're very similar accounts, but what's unique about those is that technically they are considered the child's asset. So if a child is a minor and as the parent, I want to open one of those accounts for them, I am the custodian, so I'm the one who oversees the account while they are a minor. And then when they reach age of majority, which is typically between like 18 and 21, depending on the state, once they reach that age, that account becomes theirs and they have full reign. They can use it on whatever they want. And some of the negatives there are number one, if the child does decide to go to college, those types of accounts are considered child's assets, and so they count more in terms of financial aid, which means if there's a substantial amount of money in them, that could limit the amount of financial aid the child gets, whereas if you use like a 529, that's considered a parent's asset, so it doesn't limit financial aid as much. Another negative that some people see with those accounts is that when the child reaches that certain age, that money is theirs now. And so if as the parent or the grandparent, maybe you are not confident in them managing a large sum of money, or maybe they're not responsible enough to have that, you have no say once they reach a certain age. So those are some of the negatives there. The financial aid is a big one, and the loss of control.
You know, my children had an UGMA, but I never told them that when they reached the age of majority that the money was theirs. For all they knew, it was still under my control.
Yes, I think they call that good parenting.
Some would call it that. I think in retrospect, they would call it bad parenting, but that's
probably
a story for another day. Any other types of accounts that people might consider using?
Yeah, something that I do hear parents asking about a lot, especially with young children, is just savings accounts. You know, I hear people say, oh, I'm going to open a savings account for my baby when they're born. And that is, in most cases, not optimal, because savings accounts right now are paying pretty much zero interest. And so if you're sticking cash in there, you don't have the option to invest it. And if it's money that you don't expect your child to use for many, many years, usually you are better off investing that money so it has the potential for growth. So again, it goes back to what's the goal. If the goal is money that the child is going to use many, many years down the line, a savings account is probably not ideal. But if it's money that maybe you expect to use within the next 5 years or so, maybe a savings account would make sense. And then I think another option that people don't always think about is just opening a general brokerage account. So you can open an investment account, you know, anywhere at any of the major custodians. You can open it in your own name as the parent. It's your account, but you can set it up with the purpose of saving money for your children. And ultimately, that's what my husband and I decided to do for our kids. Anytime, you know, family has given gifts, we just have a brokerage account that's kind of tagged for each of our kids. We put the money in there for them. And what's great about that is, number one, it's our account, so they don't technically have any rights to that money. So we get to help them make good decisions with it. But also, it can be used for anything. You know, say they want to go study abroad. That, you know, when they graduate high school, they can use it for that. If we wanted to help them, or, you know, buy their first car when they turn 16, they can use it for that. When they're older and they buy their first home, there's money for that. If they do go to college, it can be used for that. So it just gives a lot of flexibility. And from talking with people, I think a lot of people like that they don't have to feel like, oh man, what if my kid doesn't go to college or my grandkid doesn't go to college? This way, you're still have that option for long-term growth, but you don't have to feel like, oh, I'm going to have to pay a penalty if I use this for something other than school.
All right, Amy, I want to thank you as always for sharing your knowledge and wisdom about these topics. You have not only firsthand knowledge as a mom and a parent, but also as a financial planner.
Yep. Well, thanks for having me, Bob.